Welcome to our second session in the 2017 Ethics Week series. We're glad to have you with us. And behind me is the schedule for the week, so we hope you will join us for a couple of additional really exciting opportunities. Movie night tomorrow night with the panel to follow, and then some discussion of wealth and health management and professional athletics on Friday afternoon. I'm Jessica McManus-Wornell. I'm in management. And Brian Levy, professor in business law, Ken Milani, professor in accountancy, and Chris Adkins, professor in management, and I have been working to bring this series to fruition, and we're glad to see you here. I can stop talking now today because we have a wonderful moderator. So Mario Berkeley is a senior. He is a management consulting major, and I had the pleasure of meeting him when he participated in the inaugural class of our Business and Culture in Japan. So we spent some time in Tokyo last summer together, along with Sandra, you. And so he's going to facilitate the conversation for us today and talk a little bit, I hope, about your own story as we get through the Q&A. Maybe you're like, if I have to. Okay, great. I guess we'll introduce the team to get started, and then we'll hear from each of the panelists. Okay, so thank you, welcome. Thanks for hearing.
All right, hello everybody, welcome. Appreciate you guys being here for this panel. So I'll introduce our three panelists. You guys are really lucky today to have a good amount of diversity on the panel, just diverse in experience, and yeah. So our first is Coach Kvaratskhelia. He's the head coach of the fencing team here. Originally, he is from Georgia in the former Republic of the Soviet Union. He came here and became a U.S. citizen in 2004. He's got a wife and two children. Some of his accomplishments as a coach here, he's been the head coach here since 2014. He's one of the Irish staff since 2007. He's a 2016 co-ACC Men's and Women's Coach of the Year. He's 2015 ACC Men's Coach of the Year. He's got 38 All-Americans, 10 NCAA individual champions in his time here. Just some cool stats. 2012, the flag bearer at the U.S. Olympic team, was a former fencer here at the University of Notre Dame. He's coached the most recent student-athlete Rhodes Scholar here recently in 2015. Fencing is the most international sport here at the university. Over the last 60 years, 31 fencers and coaches have represented 31 different countries. And fencing as a team has the second most national championships in our school, second to football, with 8 national championships and then 34 individual NCAA champions. So going to be great to have his perspective here on the panel. Next to him is a fencer, Jonah Shainberg. He's originally from Rye, New York, junior management consulting major here in Mendoza. And Jonah's list of accomplishments pretty long here. 2015, 2016, 13-team All-American. He's a 2016 ACC Men's Saber champion, 2015 ACC champion Men's Saber runner-up, 2016 co-ACC Men's Saber of the Year, 2015, 2016 All-ACC, and 2015, 2016 All-ACC academic team. There's a lot more there that I can read about, but it'll take all day. So great to have Jonah on the panel as well. And then last but not least, Sandra Yu. She's a senior on the women's soccer team. She was a captain this past season, and she's been a starter the past two seasons for the soccer team. She battled through some injuries early on in her career, but she made it back to the field for the last two seasons and is pursuing a fifth year here at the university. And some of her highlights, she was the 2013 United States Under 20 Women's National Team member, in addition to being on the 2015 United States Under 23 Women's National Team. So all three of these panelists just come in here with a lot of different experience and different backgrounds, and I'm going to pass it over now to them to kind of talk about their experiences and kind of building back to our theme around building bridges through sports. So Sandra, you can kick us off.
Hi, I'm Sandra. Thanks, Mario, for the introduction. I'd first like to thank Professor McManus for inviting me to do this. It was an honor to be invited to do it, and it's a pleasure to be here. Bear with me, I am a little nervous. Typically, I'm not allowed to show my nerves because I'm an athlete, and it's usually not what we're supposed to do. but I'm going to try to do my best. I'm Sandra. I'm a senior here, and I'm a science business major. So it's kind of crazy that I'm going to be graduating soon. But I do hope to come back and pursue a fifth year, as I just applied last night to the Masters of Science and Management program, so I'm still waiting to hear back from that. So first I'm going to start off. It's not in order for some reason, but. So I'm going to start off with why I even play soccer. So I think as an athlete, sometimes this is the most important thing we need to construct. Simply because you're going to go through hard times, you're going to want to give up, and you always need to come back to the core reason why you're doing what you're doing. And I think if anybody here has had Professor Stevens, that's been instilled in you that in business, you need a why in order to sell what you want to sell. So my whys, there's a lot of them, but to start off, I'm going to start with my teammates. This is a picture of this past season after we won the ACCs. I'm in the far left right there. It was just an amazing moment, and when you accomplish something with a team, I think everyone feels a lot better about it, and you're putting in hard work together. Things get tough, you look to your left and right, and you're like, I'm going to play for this person. The next one is simply Notre Dame. So I chose to come to Notre Dame my sophomore year of high school, and I think it's the best decision I've made. The reason I put this up here is to simply remind myself that every time I do step on the field, it is something bigger than me, and that it's an opportunity to represent something much bigger than me, and with that becomes somewhat power to and the respect to uphold those traditions that are founded within the Notre Dame University. The next one I put up here is, sometimes you're just angry and frustrated, and it's the best outlet you can possibly have. So that's what soccer does for me a lot of the time. If I'm having a bad day, it's the best way for me to clear my mind. And then that's my family. So my family is my most important thing in my life. They keep me grounded, and without them, I would not be where I am without their support. So every time I step on the field, that's who I play for, and I'm thankful that they put up with me and helped me get here, because without them, I definitely wouldn't be. And then lastly, this is something that I kind of didn't realize what soccer has the power to do until I arrived at Notre Dame. We always did like surveys in high school and everything, but once I got here, it was very, very early on, it was definitely important that you use your talents in order to help others, and soccer has given me so many opportunities to not even use a soccer ball to touch the lives of others. So continuing on, backwards though. So the next thing I'm going to talk about is simply how soccer has helped me build bridges in relationships with the people around me, whether it be the people down the street or people in another country. So currently on our team, we have two foreigners from Canada and then from London. So that's just one simple example of how to break down barriers is having teammates that are simply from another place. And you can learn different cultures, different perspectives on everything. It's funny to hear their thoughts on what's going on in our country right now and things like that. Not going to get into that. And then the other one, these other two pictures right here and here, this is simply at Pearly Elementary right down the street. And this is something we've been doing since I arrived, and we go, we usually try to go once a week. Sometimes it's hard with schedule changes and everything like that. But this is a picture of them, and when we go, we simply just mentor and tutor these kids. And we sit down and try to write goals and try to provide them with information in order to set up themselves for the best future. A lot of these kids don't have the best upbringing, they don't have a two-parent home, or they're constantly moving around. So we kind of try to provide that stability in order to help them realize that there is more to achieve. And they came to our game last year, and it was a lot of fun, and they get super excited to see you, and like simply were like, I'm really nothing, but I mean, I'm glad that I'm able to help you, and it's amazing that soccer was the thing that led me to that, and I'm not even using a soccer ball or anything when I'm there, I'm simply just using words and communicating to people. And then these last two, Grassroots Soccer and the Segway Project, are both nonprofits that are very much tied to Notre Dame. So the Segway Project was actually started by a Notre Dame soccer player on the women's team. Her name was Lindsay Brown. In 2010, she won a national championship here, and her teammates started selling cupcakes. And they started to say, like, changing the world one cupcake at a time. And at the time, they didn't really take it seriously. But then they realized that they had the ability to send these children to Paul's school with the money they were raising. And that year they sent, I believe, 3 kids to school. And so then Lindsay realized it was truly making a difference. At first she didn't think it would, but it really was. And so she decided to pursue it and push it. And she started this project, and it's something that we each year we help raise awareness and donations for the project. And every year we have a Segway game, so that's just one way that we're connected over in another country. And someone here actually founded it. And then grassroots soccer is something I'll touch on a little bit more later, but Tommy Clark actually founded that, and Bobby Clark, the men's soccer coach, that's his father. So Tommy started that, and it's basically a nonprofit organization that helps raise awareness for the youth in developing countries on just like health and awareness and HIV and AIDS and things like that. And sorry to backtrack, the Segway Project stands for Soccer Empowering Girls Worldwide and You. So it is targeted towards girls, and it's to try to just like help them instill confidence and feel that they can actually take strides in the position that they find themselves in. And then lastly, I'm going to touch on how my, opportunities and the things that I've done through soccer have helped influence my perspective globally and just in a general sense. So this is just a picture in South Africa, and I think it just is fitting for perspective. But soccer has the ability to cross all boundaries and barriers. It's simply a worldwide sport that everyone plays, and you can put a ball down anywhere and anybody's gonna come and join you, basically. So in that sense, soccer is amazing because it can do that and it breaks down barriers. But what soccer has done for me when I was in South Africa, it really hit home for me when I had the time to reflect and think about what my next steps would be after soccer. I think that's something really hard as an athlete. Who am I without soccer? And when I was there, I realized that I don't have to stop playing, or I don't have to get rid of the game for the next chapter of my life. I've thought about going to medical school, still a possibility, but I really was confused on what I wanted to do because I knew I wanted to stay connected. And that's why grassroots soccer is something that I'm really passionate about. And I hope to apply after, hopefully I get into the program, but after my next year, I would love to apply and go back to South Africa for 1 year and do an internship there in order to touch the lives of them. And something that I love about that is that you are with the people and you get to see these relationships develop. As like, I love all of the little service things that we do, but to me, having that relationship and nourishing it and seeing like the progress is what I think is most important, because when people come and go out of your lives, it sometimes doesn't really stick and you don't feel the effect. So for me, going there for a whole year and truly like getting into these people's lives would really mean the world to me, and that's what I hope they can do in the future. So I think I'm gonna hand it over to Jonah. Thank you.
Hey guys, my name is Jonah. I want to introduce you to a junior here. A lot of familiar faces, which is nice. Hope you guys take good notes and get extra credit. So let's see. I'm going to start off with basically my journey to Notre Dame. Small picture, small child, that's me. For those of you who probably know, fencing is not one of the most common sports in the United States. It's definitely growing right now, but it's not, you know, something that everyone does in gym class and just decides to do. So really quickly, how I got into fencing. I went to a movie theater when I was 7 years old and saw Pirates of the Caribbean. Thought swords were awesome, that they would, if I did fencing and sword fighting, I'd get so many friends and be so cool. Not sure if the cool part actually worked out, but I did get a lot of friends from it. I did it just for fun after school. It got a lot more serious though as the years went by. That's my coach, Achico. I've been fencing for, 14 years now, which is crazy to think about. But it definitely got a lot more serious as I went on. I started traveling when I was 10 years old around the United States, doing these different tournaments, usually, you know, in the beginning just for fun, but then it led to something else. I made my first national team when I was 17 years old. That's a picture from the World Championships in Croatia in 2013. As I increased my performance, that allowed me to get recruited, and I signed my national letter of intent in November 2013 when I committed to Notre Dame, and Yes, that's how I got here, real quick. So to talk about fencing, I want to focus on three things in terms of building bridges. So first, empowering myself. I was presented with a great opportunity. My parents were extremely supportive. I was located right nearby a great fencing club with a great coach, and I was very lucky in that regard. So I was, you know, put on the right track from the beginning. Determination, anyone here who's done anything knows you gotta work really hard to get good at what you're doing. So I was very determined through practice, discipline, perseverance. So in any sport and anything you do, there's highs and lows. Gotta go, you know, challenge adversity, get through it, and that builds you up ultimately. Grit along the same lines. Later on when I got here, and I'll talk about that, teamwork became an important factor. And that has allowed me to gain a great perspective on what I do and appreciation for what I do. That's a picture from World Championships in 2015 when we medaled. We got bronze in the team event. So I mentioned that I've been traveling since I was 10. I've been to over half the states in the United States competing, and 17 countries all throughout Europe, some of them multiple times. So I've been to Poland a bunch, Germany, Hungary, only Ukraine once and Russia once, which is okay, not my favorite places, but not the end of the world. Italy, Spain, Greece, Croatia, and then Canada, Mexico, Colombia, Israel, and Uzbekistan. So that's where World Championships was a few years ago. I was in Tashkent, Uzbekistan. Never would I have thought when I was 10 years old, you know, wanting to go play with swords, that I would end up in Tashkent, Uzbekistan, representing my country in a tournament. So that was definitely an unbelievable experience. And while I didn't compete in South Africa, fencing allowed me to get to travel there on a study abroad this past summer with a few people that are actually in the room right now. So I'll get to that. I want to talk about building bridges on my team. So as Mario said, we do have one of the most diverse teams on campus. And like I've said, fencing is inherently an individual sport. For my whole life, it's been really just me competing for myself. But when you get to Notre Dame, you start to, you know, you surround yourself with different people with different abilities, different perspectives, different personalities, big and small pieces of the team, but we are all one part of the same team. So 55 people who, you know, trying to find our own way in college are all now put together and told to pursue one common goal, and that's to win an NCAA championship. And that creates a very interesting environment. We have everyone from Olympians to walk-ons on our team. Yeah, we are all expected to show up, train the same amount of hours, compete, and care as much about the team as everyone else. And that is what makes Notre Dame Notre Dame, what I think. We are all very diverse, very individual people with different experiences, yet we all come here and we're all part of the same family, and the culture is so important to us. So that was something that I needed to work on in the beginning, is really understand that when I'm fencing, I'm not fencing for just myself anymore. I'm fencing for the 55 people around me that are working just as hard to pursue the same exact goals. So building bridges with the people that are around you that are a little bit different than you, yet pursuing the same thing, was definitely an important lesson that fencing has given me. Moving on. So Sandra talked about this, but building bridges in the community and finding your why, like Professor Stevens always likes to talk about for anyone who's ever had him. So here we have us at ACC Championships last year, winning the team event, and then that's my teammate carrying me during the program. No one has heard of the program, we can talk about that later. It's the craziest 2 days of my life. That's me in South Africa, and there's Uzbekistan up there. And this is me volunteering at a at McKinley Elementary School in South Bend, which is located right down the street. So something that, you know, like I said, I didn't fence in South Africa, but when I was in South Africa, I was able to have a perspective. You know, it's a beautiful country. We were there to learn, we were there to have a good time, but it has a very calamitous history. And that was something that I couldn't ignore when I was there. So I think being able to like open my mind to where I was and seeing things for not just what they are on the surface is something that's been very important to me. And what I realized when I was in South Africa is that you don't need to fly 16 hours to the other side of the world to make a difference and experience a lifestyle that's different than our own. You can drive 5 minutes down Notre Dame Avenue, away from the Golden Dome, and you'll find a very different community around this campus. So that was something that was super important to me, and that's why I volunteer once a week. You know, we all struggle to find ourselves in college, we all struggle to empower ourselves, but if you can do that and then build bridges with the people around you, you will learn so much. The people that are around you on your team, in your classes, in your dorm, and then beyond the gates of this beautiful community that we have here. So I'd say that fencing has done that for me. It's been, you know, started as just an individual sport, became something so much more, and I'm lucky to be where I am now. Yeah, that's about it. So I'll pass it to Gia. Thank you guys.
Let's grab the papers.
Hi everyone. If you could, anyone could pronounce my last name, I'll talk to the deans to let you graduate early. So my public speaking is not my forte. It never has been since I came to States 22 years ago. And when I landed to JFK, I only knew 20 words in English, and I thought I was, you know, I could read Shakespeare. So I had to change the trains from New York to Chicago, and I lost my luggage. A lady comes to us to explain to us what happened, and half an hour into it, I did not understand a single word she was talking about. So I was thinking about go to Kansas City, was about to start working as a fencing coach, or go back home and beat the crap out of my English teacher. So, because there was nothing to say. But anyway, so I come here a little bit anxious, and then my compliance representative shows up, and my blood pressure goes to 400 right now, okay? No, I haven't done anything wrong. We are pretty compliant to what we have to do. But anyways, bad joke, no smile. I wouldn't agree to come here and speak in front of you, especially really top of the kind of food chain, you know, educated kids and professors. Not to having being indebted to Jessica here. And the reason is that Jessica's grandfather, if you know or not, was I wouldn't say the founder, but a person who brought the Notre Dame fencing to what it exists right now. The man who won the 5 national championships, but national championships and All-Americans and individual champions or Olympians had nothing to do with that, what he did for this university. And he established the academic services for student athletes and gave a fair shot to athletes to succeed on the playing field with everyone else here. Be able to graduate, and graduate with honor. And that degree really meant something. And he was the guy who did with integrity. 60 years ago, could have been really easy to fix the grades here and there, use the influence, or write the paper for someone else, and get those, you know, top-of-the-line athletes with a diploma out of the door, but he chose not to. Other thing, what he did for our program, we're talking about Costa Chica, he brought the 4 world championships in South Bend, Indiana. And that's the second to Paris. And we talk about the years back, that was unprecedented kind of fact for this place and this geographically where we are right now. We have hosted 31, the people represented from 31 different countries, either coaches or athletes, have attended and work here. Presently, we have 10 athletes from 7 different countries, the part of the Notre Dame fencing team. So for us, diversity is natural, and we thrive, and a different perspective only makes us stronger and better, and that enhances the abilities and opportunities for our kids to look at the facts and things differently and to develop to the better human beings when they're done being here at Notre Dame. So the preparation for life for us has a different flavor to it than probably somewhere else, because for us it's natural. The 3 out of the last head coaches, the last four head coaches were foreigners. So most of the times our kids don't understand what the hell are we talking about. Seriously, accents are so thick, by end of the junior year they probably get what we're talking about. So, but again, I'm honored to be here, give you a little bit of my journey, where I came from Soviet Republic of Georgia. that Soviets were not very friendly to my current country, the U.S., and if the Georgia went to war, like that never happens with the U.S., the Georgia-U.S., I don't know what I would do. This country has given me so much, and I'm so appreciative. My kids are Americans, my wife is an American, and I feel like with taking a minus an accent, I will do anything to make this country better. I don't want to mix up with the slogan with the other people, sorry about that. So, anyways, was born in Republic of Georgia, and in 1971, and to give you, take you back in the history a little bit, it's in the midst of the Cold War. The Iron Curtain is really existent. It really was real. For us, to be able to know anything about the U.S. was, you know, hard to access. I'll tell you a really funny story that Georgia is a predominantly Christian country, or 1700 years of Christian history. And the government for the Easter and for religious holidays would show all night long marathon of the American movies. It's the only time we had access to anything American. It's the movies, and with presuming that people will stay home and not go to churches, because Magnificent Seven was the probably, anyone seen that? It's a Western. The movie that would show like 20 times a day, and people would watch it because the only time a year you could do that. There was no VCR, so Iron Curtain really existed, Americans were evil. So growing up, I'm gonna tie that into the integrity a little bit. My life journey here. Growing up, the kids in a normal people, unless you're a Communist Party member, only those people have an extra benefits and opportunities to see and explore and experiment something else than being in your own town. It was really hard to break out of the mold. Growing up, you had to be either a good athlete or a good musician. So scientists make the nuclear bombs, and Russians really pride about that, and athletes represented the country the highest level, and that was the communist system's kind of showing that we can defeat you, and to build the bombs and have a fast athlete. But it also was very immoral, that if you wanted to be something really good and break it up through mold and even go to the next city, next town, next republic, because it was a part of the 15 different republics, you had to be really good. The coaches got extra benefits to raise the good kids, and could kids who achieved a very high level of athletics got the privileges to be able to travel. But on the cost of anything was possible. You used anything in your disposal to get ahead. And it was no government actually would preach that, but it was underlying kind of motif going into it. And a second, that then you get an opportunity to see the world. So break out and see something and have an opportunity to experience something else than living in a normal life every single day. So for me, the journey was, and I first experienced the immorality that the Russians actually portrayed. Actually, right now we're dealing with a Russian doping scandal. 1,500 athletes were alleged in the last two Olympics to use performance enhancement drugs to win the medals, and it was sponsored by the government. So it doesn't happen because of no reason, it happened because of the last 60 years of history. So, for example, one of these, we have electrical equipment, we use it for scoring system, and one of them device is called a grounding wire, and you put it on your electrical lame conducting, and when somebody hits you, it goes color light, either green or red, and tells the referees that someone scored. But if you take that wire off, it's kind of a clip, it will be called off target, it's like a white light. That means they missed you, the presumed target, and hit it somewhere else. They taught us in early age how to cheat and take the wire off. And one of the techniques were, and not my coach, my coach was very, very, honest man, but it was the one of the, in a handbook, how do you defeat someone? You cheat and you take the wire off. I would say that 80% of the Russian athletes, until they technology came and science caught up, had a 2 or 3 years fabricated when they competed in the world championships. So if you were got to this certain level and you were getting good, they will, your phone, your parents would get the phone call from your the school or the academy, and they'll say, okay, you need to go to a certain place and I'll change the birth certificate, which makes you three years younger. So 23 years old Russian athletes will compete against 18-year-old Europeans and Americans. Now, we're also talking about the highest level of the preparation. Those guys were incredibly good and had cheated. So for me, growing up, only deterrent for that was the family that I grew up in and the values. You know, kind of our, you know, for me, the growing English Christian person, every religion preaches the tolerance, honesty, integrity, and home. So coming to U.S. was a little different because, you know, yet I've been told at home, don't do this, don't do this. But when you have an 18-year-old kid dealing with that kind of circumstances, oh, I could go to Germany. In West Germany, it was the time when I started traveling, it was East and West. And it was like you going to the Mars the first time I left the Soviet Union and went to a capitalistic country. It really was that, I mean, life-changing experience. That was for me that, okay, I'm going to work really hard to not to stay and experience a lifestyle somewhere else. But integrity was not that meaningful where I come from. And then you come to Notre Dame, and I had a detour, came to the States and lived in Kansas for 10 years and kind of got to know what is the life is all about here and come to Notre Dame and was mentored by someone like Coach DeChico, truly changed everything in me. So, going my blood pressure up to 400 with the compliance, they said it was a joke, guys, really, really, right? Nothing to hide here. But the life, I don't know how the life, you know, goes. From the country who was absolutely adversary to yours. And we apparently in the 60s, we went to the missile crisis with Cuba that was a one button away would this world probably would have ceased exist. And the first competition I went to Germany, we had, I was 14 years old. And I had to go to 4 different interviews in my district, my city, in a republic, and a national level. It was in Moscow with the KGB operatives, so make sure I did not stay in West Germany, in a barn. So it's like 14-year-old kid, I just wanted to see my family coming back. I mean, I had no reason to stay in Germany, everyone was at home, but that was a system. So 4 different interviews that and again, the theme was when you see the Americans, you don't talk to them. Do not have any kind of contacts in America with Americans. So maybe my childhood was not as bad as like people experience it right now in North Korea. Because that's North Korea would equal the Soviet Union in 40s and 50s, but not in 70s and 80s. And I look back and everything was phenomenal. But today's perspective, the human rights, or the ability to express yourself, the ability to say whatever you want to say, the freedom of speech. I mean, a lot of people take it for granted, and I tell them, my kids, and how lucky they are to be part of this campus here called America. But on the other hand, I think the diversity what we have in the fencing team, or diversity at all, only makes us better. Diversity could be the national, religion, or ethnic, or racial, that's what we are, and again, the theme is let's stand up for what we believe. But lucky to have the students like I have in the fencing. I am lucky to work with them here, and just lucky to talk to you guys. So any questions, I'm at your disposal. Thank you very much.
So we've got kind of a lot of time, you guys. In. So we have about 25 minutes for you guys to kind of ask any questions or just pose a discussion. You know, this is for you guys to kind of get something out of this. We got 3 great panelists up here. So any questions you guys have or anything for these guys? So I'll start.
started off with a question. Yeah, well.
I see a lot of my students. I know you have some great questions, right? About ethics and anybody?
Are
you started?
I got one. So what exactly, I don't know who's gonna answer or okay, whatever. What's like the hardest part of building global bridges through sports? Like what's been difficult? Like, has there been any challenges? I mean, I know you talked about like language barriers and like different perspectives. Like, is there, I don't know, is there specific struggles, I don't know, that you guys might experience?
I'll go ahead and answer. I think one thing that is hard in the context that like Jonah and I talked about, where we kind of in the community kind of try to help and build bridges, is that to really think that you are making a difference. I think that when you go over there, when I was in South Africa, I did the same thing that he did. I just did a year before him, and I was there for 3 weeks, and we went to the township of Soweto, and we were hanging out with these kids. And something that just like really stuck with me after was when we had class, or Professor Andre, I don't know if any of you guys have had him, but very outspoken man, and I love that guy, but he was saying afterwards that it kind of made me really think of what we were doing when we were there, and it was like, he wasn't talking down on what we were doing in the sense that we were going there and it felt like it was helping these kids, but he was like, we need to look at the core. Like, I think people forget that, like, you do need to look at the core problem. So, like, for me, that's kind of why when I talk about grassroots, it's, yeah, it's nice to help every once in a while when you're out there, and there's no harm in that at all. But at the end of the day, like, you're going to need those people that are willing to stick with it and actually see these people's lives change. So I think that's something that's really important. And I had another thought, but now I forget. Sorry.
Yeah, I guess just adding to that, I was going to say something similar probably about South Africa. But, you know, when Sandra said that sports breaks barriers, I think we take for granted something like the Olympics and how unbelievable of an event that is. Every, you know, 2 years you get the winter and then you get the summer 4 years later, or 2 years later, to have countries from, and I've never been there, full disclosure, never been there, but you have countries from all over the world, you know, different people coming together. I had that at World Championships, you know, when in fencing you get to compete against some people from all over. Most of the tournaments are over there, so as an American traveling to Uzbekistan, to Russia, to Ukraine, you get, you know, while they don't know who you are, they see your country on the back of your lame, and there are definitely some bouts that are a little bit more intense than others, I would say. But yeah, I think, you know, I don't really know how many areas of life there are other than sports that allows you to really go and just drop everything else and just do it for the love of the game. So I guess I'm lucky in that regard that I get to experience that.
And even going off of that, something that I was thinking about was if you saw the commercial that Nike just put out, I think something that's hard for us to do sometimes that there is that it's going to cause issues sometimes. I think that people have seen that is causing some negotiate or some discussions and things like that, but like at the end of the day, what you're saying is like sport does give you that opportunity to forget about any type of, I don't know, like race, gender, like religion, things like that. Like, you have the equal opportunity when you're playing or fighting against someone on a field, like you're playing by the same rules, so like why can't that translate off of the field?
Jonah mentioned the Olympics, and in ancient Greece, the wars would stop during the Olympics. In 2008, I'm against Russians, but we were in Georgia, and the first day of Olympics, Russians invaded my country, so we were lucky enough to get out, but Russians break the rules. That's I could be a little subjective about it. But it's besides an art, the sport is the thing that would make the peace between the nations and unite the people for the common good and common, like, the common good, as I said. So I think the sport has the ability to do that, and Olympics would have been one of that.
I have a question. So one of the themes of the week related to this is sort of life lessons from sports, and you've given us some very good ones, obviously. Take us from, you know, preparing for a soccer game, to preparing for a presentation, an interview, or a fencing match. Does it translate for the mental preparation, the visualization, that kind of thing?
Yeah, so let's see. I'll say the thing about fencing is that, in, you know, with most sports, no two bouts are the same ever. So you're gonna, I'm fencing, could be the same person in practice every day. Every bout will be different. Every touch will be different. So I'd say like quick thinking on my feet, being able to adapt. You know, I'm lucky. I'm so grateful. I've had the opportunity to go to so many countries. And whether, you know, you're up 4-0 in a bout fencing someone from France, or down 3-1 fencing someone from Russia, it could be for a medal, it could be not. It's, you know, I've been in so many situations that require me to adapt very quickly. So I think, you know, with regards to work and interviewing, when you never really know what you're going to get, being able to adapt very quickly is something that I've got from fencing.
Yeah, I definitely think that how I prepare for a sport or how I interact with the people within my sport carries over to when I'm either in the classroom or preparing for things like this or interviews or things like that. I think something that you really gain from a sport is like how to respect people. And I think that is something that carries over immensely when you're in a classroom. And I think that's something that athletes might not have that reputation about, respect. But for me personally, I've learned that at home, and then I've always learned to respect people that are in that position to teach you and help you get to where you need to be. And I think that my coaches and administration here have definitely been in that role, and I've given that respect because I know that at the end of the day, it's like people are helping me along. And then the same thing with adapting to situations. Yeah, like putting things together last minute or just changes in schedules, it definitely carries over to other parts of your life.
I'm going to ask you guys something. So as student athletes, you guys have had opportunities to go abroad and compete. So did that play into your factor at all when you were deciding on, you know, coming to Notre Dame? Was there any appeal that Notre Dame has that global brand, and also you have the opportunities with a school like Notre Dame and the division we play in to kind of go abroad and play different teams and different things like that?
So yeah, well, through Notre Dame, I have had the opportunity to go abroad. I actually have never competed abroad with Notre Dame, unfortunately. My team did go to France, but I did not go. I was injured. That was this past summer. But I mean, just the fact that I was able to go to Japan and South Africa through Notre Dame, and if I didn't play soccer, it wouldn't have happened. I know that. And the fact that soccer led to those opportunities is something that I'm thankful that Notre Dame gave me that.
So the weird thing about fencing is that it really is like a year-round sport. At Notre Dame, the NCAA season is primarily from January to the end of March, with a few tournaments in the beginning of the year. I also have like the international season, so I go to World Cups kind of scattered throughout September until April, and then I have these U.S. tournaments from September to July. Basically just leaves August, so I don't have anything in August. But yeah, so Notre Dame has been, you know, that was something that was on my mind. I did want to go to a place where I'd be able to do, or at least try to do everything and keep that going, because, you know, while Notre Dame is my ultimate priority right now to win a championship here, I also have my own goals outside of Notre Dame, and Notre Dame was one of the few schools that was very supportive of that. So yeah, it was a no-brainer for me.
The last two Olympics, we had the most representation from all the other colleges. We had 5 in London and 5 in Rio. So our biggest selling point that you will get a great education and you'll achieve your Olympic dreams, as well as you could win the NCAA championship. So we have this trifecta effect on recruiting field, so that we use it and truly enhancing their dreams to come to reality. So opportunity.
Did you reflect on a lack of understanding or a mistake you made while you were traveling internationally, and what did you learn from that experience?
I can easily take this on. When I was abroad in Japan, I was with Mario, and I was also with Professor McManus, and Japan is a very, we've heard, like, a very peaceful country, and it's pretty quiet. And we did this lesson in class where we went back and forth. We were with Japanese students at Keio University, and we went back and forth describing stereotypes of what we didn't really want to fulfill, but essentially at the hotel we were staying at, we got complaints about being too loud. And
it wasn't us, too.
Yeah, it wasn't us. But still, we were
being ordinary American college
students
in a country that is.
I think we were, in a way, we didn't really think too much about coming into there and really embracing their culture right away, and I think that is something that a lot of Americans need to work on when we do go abroad. I think we have this notion where we go and we expect people to still speak English to us, and I'm just like, I'm in your country, why should I expect that ever? And I think that is something that we need to work on when we do go abroad, and to really look into the culture before you even go, just to understand it so that you can feel like you are truly respecting that and actually learning about it.
I do think one thing that was fascinating about going to Japan is seeing yourself as an American through like someone else's lens. So you never get that feedback in America. Like no one, you're not just walking around the streets of New York being called an American. You're just not saying that to people. You're all, here we view people, you know, different things like race, class, and things like that. When you go abroad, you know, you have a simple conversation with somebody, they'll just say to you like, oh, like where, you know, they can pick up like that you're American. They don't look at the different factors that we might dissect here. So like just viewing yourself through that lens just kind of gives you this perspective now. Like you just see the world in a different light. You really do see that, like Sandra was saying, it doesn't revolve around us. Like everybody in another country has been able to achieve and build, you know, build relationships, build up buildings like us. Like everybody's been successful at some level. So it's not like we have like the grand formula for everything. So that's kind of fascinating when you definitely go travel abroad, especially to a place like Asia, which stereotypically for us here is like the other side of the world. Like there's all this other stuff going on over there, but it's really not. It's really just a fascinating experience when you actually get to go outside your comfort zone and do stuff like that.
Yeah. So building upon that, I think, you know, I can talk about South Africa when and Dean was there, Meg was there, Justin, you're there, and we really. You know, coming from Notre Dame, which is this, and I talked about this when I was up there, but like this beautiful place where we really do have it all. And then all of a sudden, like the first 2 weeks we were in Cape Town, which is this beautiful city on the beach, and we were going to these really awesome bars and having these amazing meals cooked for us in our home. And then the next day we'd go into the townships and we would have armed security with us and we'd drive by, you know, children just running around and dogs running around. And you know, our professor told us, you know, in most houses there's an AK-47 probably leaning against the door. And I think in the beginning it was kind of just like, oh, like I didn't really know how to process it because it's just so different from what I'm used to, where it's like you almost watch a movie and you think it doesn't really exist, but it does. And, you know, I had that experience. I was in Colombia competing and we drove by slums, and just realized, like, thinking that we didn't have that here was definitely wrong of me, because I've never seen it. And that's why, you know, I have taken it upon myself to really kind of drive out of here and see what's really 5 minutes away. I've had a very lucky life, like upbringing. Like I said, my parents have supported me with everything. I come from a good area. I'd say like just the perspective I got from really going outside my comfort zone has opened my eyes that the world isn't all it's, you know, perfect that we really think it is. And the problems that maybe I have here are just not much in comparison to what other people deal with. So just being a little bit more selfless and aware of our privileges is definitely an important lesson that I learned from that.
It's never good news when your student is talking about bars, okay?
Legal age there, South Africa, the age is 18, I was not breaking any laws.
I'll leave this topic here.
My first time in a bar.
Yes. We had this joke, and growing up, you know, we all stereotype other nations, and especially Europeans are pretty notorious about that. And so what do you call someone who speaks three languages, and it's a trilingual, and who speaks two languages, a bilingual, and who speaks one language is an American. So something about us, you know, that I would encourage you guys to just go and experience the world outside, because we live in the bubble, and we see everything with this, the prism of CNN or CNBC or Fox News and whatever you guys watch, but to be able to see how others communicate, how others function, and and accept that as a normal. So nothing divides us. So I encourage, if you have an opportunity, to go somewhere else and make a difference and help those people will be the best thing in the world. And I have one more story. It's my most favorite story of all. I have a friend who lives in San Francisco, and I come from Georgia, who I still keep in touch and communicate with people in Georgia. And one of my friends from San Francisco called me, and she's crying. We had a same kind of friend who was a priest, happened to be a priest. We both knew him. And gets the story from, she calls him, that we know both this guy, and apparently he's a priest, and has this, two people show up, and it's the 90s in Georgia, it's a depression to the monumental level. Civil war is engulfed, and people have no food, and you have to stay like 20 hours in the bread to get a loaf of bread. And gets two people come to his house, and to the priest's house, and knock on the door, and gets, Father, you know, we just got out of prison, and we need a place to stay, we need a place to work. So he takes those two guys to the monastery and gives them a, you know, work. You know, they have to chop the wood and help the monks over there, or the nuns, whoever there. And they have some kind of salary for that. Well, 5 days into it, they robbed the monastery, those two guys, and took off. And they took whatever the gold was there, or the icons with the gold, and whatever money those poor people have. So this girl calls me, and just absolutely devastated. You know, things could happen in human nature. You know, human could do such things such that. So I said, you know, what do we do? We talked about it, and maybe we'll talk to others and raise some money to send those people, you know, that church to recoup that damages. She goes to church next day, you know, and tells the story to someone else. And then a week later, she comes to the next service, a week later, you know, Sunday service, and there was the money already raised for her, for them, and for this girl to send back to Georgia. Now, can you imagine a feeling of that priest who received that $500 in the following week? I mean, truly, the world is a very small place and miracles could happen. But this is my favorite story. Maybe it doesn't have a topic to what we had to talk about. But, you know, something, you know, the help is always on the way, and good things will come who really, really hope for it, guys. So go out there and explore the world and help the others to become better. That's my message to you. So.
Yeah.